Everyone wants someone special. Someone who will take interest in everything they care about. Someone who'll send them gifts and stuff. Who'll think about them all the time. Doodle their name in class. Talk about them incessantly. And who'll worry about them day and night. Everyone wants someone special. Until they get a stalker. I'm not proud of the story that I'm about to tell you. I make a lot of mistakes in it. 5, to be precise. Yes, tonight I am going to be Chetan Bhagat and tell you about the 5 mistakes of my life. I hope you take heart from them and learn from them, even if I didn't. Most of all, I want to tell you this story today, not because it's entertaining, but because we live in a country and in a culture that trivializes stalking. On screen, some guy devotes himself to prove his love to some lady who is clearly exasperated and completely uninterested, and an audience of 200 people go, "Oh my God, this is so romantic!" Seriously, you want to be in a relationship with a person who'll throw everything away in a second for an ounce of your attention? Or even worse, someone who will harm themselves out of a sign of supposed love for you? Darling, you didn't pick up the phone and so I lopped off a toe. Darling, you didn't hug me yesterday, so I chopped off a ear. After 1 year, you will find yourself married to a torso with no limbs, much like Darth Vader. I was in my first year at IIM Calcutta and I had just landed an internship with a top consulting firm. I was manning, or rather personing, the reception area. I was managing the phones, directing other students looking for internships as to where to go for the next interviews and so forth. And that was how I met my stalker. As I later found out, that was not how my stalker met me. Stalkers typically have a way of meeting you long before you meet them. He had an air of anxiousness around him as he came up and said, "Hi, this seat here seems to be empty," sitting down next to me. He sat there, fidgeting a bit, occasionally awkwardly participating in the banter around the front desk that Abhishek, Rishikesh and I had going. All I remember about him from that day was his nervousness, the fact that he made me uncomfortable for some reason, and his name. Yes, my stalker had a name. He is a person with feelings and intelligence who now has a great career. But tonight, I will not tell you his name. Tonight, I will proceed to dehumanize him a little, just as he dehumanized me. He was back the next day, surer, better dressed, and smelling like an entire bottle of aftershave had been emptied on his head. At the end of a long, very strange day, punctuated by him paying me rehearsed compliments that sounded like they came from Men's Health magazine, he stopped, squared his shoulders to me, looked into my eyes and said, "I have a crush on you, a very big one." And then I made the first mistake in the story. I tried to use logic. "Thank you, that's very flattering," I said, "but you've only known me a few hours. I find it hard to understand how anyone can have a crush on someone they don't really know. But I know you. I know pretty much everything there is to know about you." "Crap. I've been observing you for a while, and I can't get you out of my head." Just then, Abhishek came around to the front desk and plonked himself next to me. "Go get something to eat, CD. I'll man the desk," he said. To this day, I wonder if he had heard just what had transpired and came in to help me, or if it was just coincidence that he sat down when he did. I had escaped. But only for now. Little did I know then that this was day 2 of a story that was to be stretched over the course of the next 5 years. Some days later, my friend Raji and I went on one of our evening walks around the largest lake in the IIM Calcutta campus. Over the preceding few months, she and I had gotten into the habit of taking a couple of rounds around the lake every night after dinner, discussing the events of the day. Minutes into our walk that night, I heard footsteps behind us. This didn't alarm me in particular because Raji and I were hardly the only fools on campus who were willing to be shat upon by birds after dinner. There would always be students taking walks around the campus at any given point in time, be it 7 a.m. in the morning or 3 a.m. in the night. The shuffling footsteps caught up to us. "May I join you, ladies?" said a shaky male voice. And there he was, nervous, sweaty, and stammering as usual. Raji and I exchanged glances. Her glance said, "Why is this guy sweating so much in the middle of November?" My wide eyes silently screamed at her, "Say no, Raji. Please say no. For once, be the unfriendly person instead of the wonderful, sweet person that you are. Just say no." Raji said something nearly as good. She looked at him and answered his question with, "Why?" He said, "Because I'd like to walk with you. That isn't a crime, is it?" This was when I made my second mistake of the story, politeness. I said, "Of course, apologies if we are being rude. Please feel free to join us." The three of us, an odd trio now, continued with our walk in complete silence. After one round, as opposed to our usual three or four, I muttered in a tone way too formal for me, "I have a coursework-related meeting and Raji does too, so we gotta run." He looked at me curiously and with genuine concern. "Cutting short your walk because of me, Moonlight? It's usually longer, isn't it?" Moonlight. A translation of my name. There it was, for the first time. I've been addressed by many names by many people throughout the course of my life. The formal Chandrima, my initials CD, the affectionate Siddhi, Chan, Chanda, the cuddly Chandu, the mildly theatrical Chandramukhi, and then Shamindra, the odd thing a 50-year-old client from Arlington, Virginia once christened me. But the literal Sanskrit translation, so appropriate, simple, personal. Over the course of the next 5 years, I grew to hate it. I hate Moonlight. Ping. The IP messenger I had installed on my laptop buzzed yet again. This was a LAN messaging system popular with the internet nerds on campus at the time, which includes me. We liked to share links to files, inside jokes, ran internet radios, broadcast announcements over this IP messenger. It was our internal Reddit, 9gag and Twitter all rolled into one. The ping said I had a private message. Private messages were very unusual. And unlike Gmail or GChat, unblockable. I opened it. "What's up, Moonlight?" it said. I did not respond. "Are you angry, Moonlight?" "No," I replied. "I am not angry. I have no cause to be angry about here. But you are making me very uncomfortable. Please stop." Next thing. "Is it so bad that I want to be around you?" Now, I consider myself someone who can see things from the other person's perspective. The burden of empathy is what I call it. It prevented me from being preemptively mean to him. After all, he had not harmed me, nor had he displayed any intentions of doing so. At this point, he was just being mildly annoying. "I think I understand where you're coming from. It is perfectly natural to feel attracted to someone, but the kind of behavior you're exhibiting makes life very difficult for me. You don't even know me." I typed all of that out. "But I do. I know what you're good at and what you like. I've seen your grades. I know who your friends are. I just heard you sing 15 minutes ago." I froze. I was singing 15 minutes ago in my hostel room with the door closed. When I didn't reply, after a few minutes, he pinged again. "Are you very busy, Moonlight? So busy that you can't reply to me." I replied with the three words I had been holding back for a week now. "Stop stalking me." He replied immediately, "But I am not stalking you. I just have a crush on you. I don't understand why you have a problem with that. I am not even asking you to spend time with me." Of course, he was right, as stalkers always are, following me, keeping track of my activities, finding out who I hang out with, harassing me, pinging me continuously, were all born out of love, affection and caring, as Bollywood movies would have us believe. And here, I made the third mistake in this story. I did not uninstall IP Messenger. I would reply. I tried reasoning with him in the beginning, explaining my position. I did this in the belief that I would not let this one annoying, persistent person dictate my decisions and my behavior. I was a strong, independent woman. I could totally handle a stalker with grace, humor, and empathy. I would kill him with kindness. I would show him that I too was a person, not the mere object of his affection. He would see me as a human being, not as this goddess on a pedestal. I would tell him that not every person you're attracted to is obligated to respond in kind, and that I already had someone in my life at the time, and he would understand and back off. He seemed to be an intelligent person. As it turned out, I was an idiot for thinking this. The pings continued, more desperate, more frequent. My initial attempts to be rational, reasonable, and clarify my position tapered down. At the end of 4 weeks of this harassment, most of his pings started going unanswered by me. There were messages to tell me where he had seen me that day, pings to tell me why I shouldn't be spending time with certain male friends of mine, and even pings to tell me how I looked on certain days. On the 14th of February 2009, about 3 months after this started, at 2 a.m. in the morning, I heard a knock on my door. Being the night owl that I am, I was awake. I had posted something odd, funny, silly on the IP Messenger, as I was often known to do. While it may seem unusual in other contexts, there's nothing odd about having a visitor at 2 a.m. in the night when you're on campus. But little did I know who was on the other side of the door. He stood outside with a bouquet of flowers and a box of chocolates, sweating profusely, as anxious and as nervous as the last time I had seen him, which had been the incident of the walk around the lake with Raji. Despite pinging me up to 15 times a day in the last 3 months, he hadn't gathered the nerve to meet me all this time, a lack of courage I was extremely grateful for, right until this very moment. "For you," is all he said as he stood there, fidgeting nervously, arms outstretched, SRK style. You know the line that's coming next. This was when I made the fourth mistake of the story. I took the box and the bouquet from his outstretched arm. I still don't know what compelled me to do it. He smiled triumphantly. Then I realized what I had just done. I motioned to hand the gifts back to him. "Happy Valentine's Day," he said, as he quickly walked away from the doorway and disappeared down the stairs. I stood there on the doorway, completely mortified by my own stupidity. A few seconds later, my neighbor passed me standing there, motionless and quite confused, on her way to the bathroom. She stopped. "Oh wow, who are these from?" "These are from the creepy guy I told you about. He came, handed these to me and just left." "So cute!" she shrieked, jumping in pure glee. Her excitement was inversely proportional to my sense of dread. My acceptance of this gift would forever be held against me. In his head, he had probably just paid up for all the harassment that he had bestowed upon me. Had I just endorsed his behavior, would it now all be on my head? Had I just been handed a bomb and not had the sense to run away from the very sight of it? He continued to stalk me with the same intensity till the time he graduated in March 2009. His one-sided rants would range from friendly and funny to pleading attempts at emotional blackmail. "Do you think you're too good for me? You are an arrogant, heartless, but you can't see how much I suffer because of you. I can't study, I can't sleep, I am on medication, but you don't care. You wouldn't care if something happened to me, would you?" I eventually responded by writing to him and explained that I was going to uninstall Messenger and block him everywhere else. Too little, too late, of course. I had earlier given up trying to convince him that I was a person. Now I had given up my silence. He responded by calling me on my phone. Numbers were freely available in the campus directory and demanding an explanation. We are insidiously conditioned to think that whoever exhibits greater signs of suffering and pain in a situation is naturally the victim. Our movies condition us to believe that the recipients of unrequited love have it very easy. They are selfish, heartless people who cannot see the awesome sauce creatures their stalkers are. I was the villain. He was somehow the victim. I can't change how I feel about you. What terrible things have I done, Moonlight? Have I ever caused you any harm? He said, stammering. His voice sounded hoarse, like he had been weeping. I had pondered this question for a while now. When he had initially started stalking me, my ready answer to this very question would have been no. But my answer had changed. You have held me responsible for your feelings, a responsibility that I would politely like to decline. You are inherently selfish and lack empathy. You claim that you have feelings for me, but I have never experienced anyone so inconsiderate towards another human being. My decisions, my willingness, my consent or lack of consent is of no consequence to you. And yet, you claim that you care deeply about me. You have induced fear in me, and you have made me start to look behind where I never used to before. If your aim was to make me feel guilty about my very existence, then yes, you nearly succeeded. But I won't let you pin your weaknesses and your obsessive behavior on me. I am not responsible for you. You are responsible for you. I cut the call. I did not pick his calls thereafter. After he graduated, the frequency of these attempts to interact died down eventually. Eventually, as in one whole year. I would sometimes get odd anonymous emails of a stalkery disposition. I'm sure it was him, even though I cannot pin them down to him since they are anonymous. I would like to believe it was him primarily because one stalker at a time is all I can handle. After 2 years of complete silence, in May 2013, he contacted me again, having obtained my phone number from a mutual friend. He contacted me to tell me that he was doing fine and had been cured. He hadn't been obsessed with me for a while now, to use his own words. He had undergone therapy and he just wanted me to know that. I welcomed his cured state of being and wished him well. My final mistake. The next day, he called me again and proceeded to tell me about how he had undergone aversion therapy using shock treatment, adding after a pause, all for you, Moonlight. Whatever aversion therapy he had undergone, it clearly hadn't worked. He was back, stammering less, and now armed with the confidence to actually speak to me. I pitched one last effort to tell him how any interactions with me were just plain bad for him. It clearly caused him problems, and at the rate that he was going, he would never get over his illogical obsession. After I finished, I blocked him on my phone. He hasn't gotten back in touch since. I don't feel relief, however. I have permanently turned into someone looking over my shoulder. I subconsciously dread picking up the phone when I get calls from unknown numbers. I wonder sometimes when the next anonymous email will drop into my inbox and all of the baggage that comes with it. And that leads us to the problem with this story. It doesn't have an ending. The ending of a story is about finding a way to close that's meaningful and satisfying. This story is incomplete. It's incomplete because, unlike my other stories, the ending of the story is not in my hands. I don't have the power to end it. I don't have the power to end his obsession with me. Only he does. And I hope that he has. Thank you.